Oh. Hi everyone. Okay, so welcome back. You guys had asked me if, well, you guys didn't ask me, I asked you guys if you guys wanted a part two about Dazz, and a lot of you said yes. So this video is gonna be a lot more about like who he was and just everything about him. I had some questions that people want me to answer, and you know, I'm gonna try my best to keep it together. But yeah, cause you know, some of the questions are a little bit like in depth as to, you know, like towards his death and everything. So that's a very like, you know, still to this day, you know, it's still a very sensitive topic for me. But I'm still gonna do it. And look at my shirt. It says Dazz. One of his like great friends, Gus, he does them. And I was very happy that he gave me a Melania shirt. She got a little sweater. But she can't wear it yet because it's so big on her. But she'll wear it soon. Let me see if I find it actually. So look at her shirt, her sweater. It says Dazz on it. It's very cute, I like it. I'm like trying to get comfortable. But yeah, that's more close up. Okay, that's more close, okay. Sorry guys, I had to fix the camera because it just looked weird to me. Still kind of does, but whatever, I don't even care. So let's get to it. So as you guys know, me and Dazz, we had met in college. But before, you know, college, he was a very, very, like, big athlete from where he's from. He's from Linden, New Jersey. He was born in January 4th, 1995. He had turned 23 years old. So he played Linden football for a very long time. I'm gonna see if I could put some clips of his football. If you go on YouTube and you Google Dazzmen Johnson, it'll come up a lot of his football videos. But I'm gonna see if I could put it for you guys. And then when he got to college, he played basketball and he also played rugby, which he was an amazing rugby player. He was the captain of the rugby team, which I was, you know, very proud of him. He got MVP, I think it was, yeah, the first year that they started rugby in Monroe College, which I wish I knew where that trophy was, because, you know, that's a trophy that it was one of his achievements, and I want Milani to, you know, see what her dad did. I just wish I knew where it was. If anyone knows, can you please let me know where that trophy is? Because honestly, I really do want it. I have a picture of him with it, but you know, it's nothing like having it there. So yeah. But he played rugby, he played basketball, he played football. He was very athletic, very, very athletic. But yeah, let me just get to the questions to see. One of them is, did he let his health affect how he played? Towards the end, yes, he did. He couldn't play anymore. And that really took a big toll of him because, you know, all he did was, you know, play. And, you know, now that he wasn't able to play, it was like, what can he do now? And yeah, so that took a lot out of him, not being able to play anymore. Let's see. How was his relationship with Melani? Like, listen, there was no, I don't even know how to describe it. Them two were like unbreakable. Like, they were just, he didn't even sleep at night sometimes because I was exhausted, but he didn't sleep at night. Even though coming back from dialysis and everything, he still would just watch her. Like, if she, real quick, if she made a noise, he would, right away, he would go and check on her and everything. And at times, she ended up being in our bed because, you know, he wanted her closer to us. Them two were just amazing. It sucks for me that, you know, it sucks because, you know, I have such an amazing relationship with my father that, listen, no one can tell me nothing about my dad, no one. And I really wish that for her so much. And when he passed away, it was like, you know, what? When she's older, what do I tell her? Like, how would she feel? Because, you know, all I think about a lot is like when she grows up and she goes to school and she sees these little girls or her friends, you know, with her, their dads and stuff. And, you know, she's gonna ask me, you know, why, or like just ask me a lot of questions. And I just, you know, it's gonna be really hard for me. It was really hard for her when he had passed. Like, for a couple weeks, it was really hard because she was always on him. Like, for her to sleep, it had to be on top of him. So it was really hard, like, you know, trying to adjust. I had to, you know, at one point, you know, his shirts that still smelled like him, you know, I had to give it to her. I'll put it on the next slide. To give her his shirt in order for her to, you know, stop crying or just to sleep just for a little bit, just so she could smell him. One of his friends, Abdul, he gave me an oil that Dazz used to put, and at one point I had to rub that oil like on her blanket, anywhere, just in order for her to, you know, fall asleep. Or for her to feel like, you know, that he's like still around, you know, that's, you know, that was hard. That was very hard. Very hard. How was he on his last days? He was, you know, towards the end, he was already sick. Like, you could see it in a lot of pictures. He had lost a lot of weight. A lot of weight. He lost. So, you know, he was, you know, on and off. He felt, one minute he felt amazing. He had so much energy. He wanted to do things. And then the next, it was just like he just was weak. He didn't want to do anything. Wednesday before his passing, I had to work that day. So he stayed with the baby. That was the funniest thing, because dads never like to change diapers, especially diapers with some you know what in it. And I remember he had called me, he FaceTimed me like 4 times. I'm like, I'm already panicking, like, what's going on? He's like, your daughter, she took a shit. I'm like, so you gotta clean it, you know, you have to clean it. He's like, no, I don't think I could do it. I'm like, Dazz, I still got like 5 more hours. You have to clean her diaper. You can't just keep her like that. You have to clean her diaper. So he was like, all right, fine. So I had to be on FaceTime with him. Oh my God, I remember he had texted me, the baby's on the couch. I think I still have that text message. The baby is on the couch, laid down, and he has the diaper like this, and he took a picture. Oh my goodness, when I got home, he was like this. He was exhausted. He had never spent a whole day alone with the baby, and he did it. He did an amazing job. He did it. But he was so happy to see my mom come home, then my grandmother, because it was my mom's birthday. Mama Stella came, and when he saw me, his eyes were like this, like, yes, I'm off duty. So yeah, he was good that day. The next day was his birthday. He wasn't feeling too good, but he wanted to try to make the best of it because it was his birthday. You know, he was a little bit, you know, happy that it was his birthday. I made his favorite pasta. I made pasta, you know. That day I was so tired, I had to take a nap, and I remember him waking me up like, don't take a nap, hurry, wake up. And I'm like, I am so tired. And he's like, no, come on, wake up. So I woke up, and then towards the end, he wasn't feeling good. And then, you know what happened the next day. How did you guys spend his last birthday? It was a snowstorm that day. It was a big snowstorm that day, so we didn't really go anywhere. We stayed inside. Well, we went to the store real quick to buy the stuff for his birthday dinner, and we actually bought, because you know, your girl was 21 already, so we bought the hard lemonades. We bought those. We're like, hey, we'll drink, you know, one or two. We'll watch a movie since there's nothing else to do. I make dinner. You know, we ended up not drinking anything. He ate his food. Then he was starting to feel so much better. And then I was really tired, so I wanted to take a nap. So, yeah. But, you know, we were together, you know, just as a family here. My mom was home too. DJ was home. The baby, of course, was here. And we were just all together here. Who was he overall? You guys were super tight. Describe him to us. Yeah, we were together every single day. Once, you know, he got more sick and my mom ended up letting him stay here with us because his dialysis was here, and he's just, you know, he wanted to stay here with the baby, so my mother let him stay here. We were just here, but we were together every single day from the minute we woke up to the minute we went to sleep. You know, the only time we weren't together is when he had to go to his dialysis 3 times a week. But after that, he was here with us. And, you know, like, many relationships in the beginning we had, it was a bumpy road for us, a very, very, very bumpy road. But, you know, we realized what we wanted, and of course, that was each other. So we were just, when I stayed at Monroe, I stayed in his room with him. We were just always together. And then when I just, you know, I got pregnant, I came back here. He was in Monroe and I was here. And it was kind of hard because, you know, I was pregnant and all I want is him to be with me. Well, yeah, you know, him to be with me at all time. Like, not all times because I had to work as well. But, you know, I wanted to be with him. He tried his best to come over here. You know, I went over there here and there because I still had, you know, my friends over there. So, yeah, we were, you know, together all the time. When he had passed, it was extremely, 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 extremely hard for me. Just because the fact that I was so used to the three of us, and now, you know, I had to get used to just the two of us, of me and Meilani. So that was pretty hard for me. It was just really, 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 really hard. It was to a point where I couldn't even sleep in my own room. Like, it couldn't happen. You know, I had 3 months where I slept on the couch because I couldn't sleep in my room. I was so used to somebody with me all the time, and to not have that at night is when, you know, finally, I never wanted to show, you know, the baby that I was sad or anything. And, you know, when she fell asleep at night, and I was just, you know, laying down, and that's when, you know, everything comes up, like, just a lot goes on, and I just couldn't sleep in my room. So I lasted 3 months without being in my room, and when I came back from Boston, I was like, I have to do this, like, I have to come back to my room. So I came back to my room. But I only slept in my room for like maybe 2 weeks, and then I went back to the couch. And you know, now I sleep in my bed. Of course, I sleep with Meilani. You know, she don't sleep in her bassinet anymore. I tried to put her there, but it doesn't work. So she sleeps with me, and we sleep together every night. And I don't care what anyone says. Say, oh, don't get her used to it. I don't care. She's gonna sleep with me. And that's it. Was his sickness a shock, or did it run in his family? He didn't look like it at all. He had problems when he was in high school, but they had given him medicine and stuff for it. And then when he was in July of 2017, we ended up going to the hospital because he said that I gave him food poisoning, but I didn't give him no food poisoning. Like, I just didn't. He wasn't feeling good, so we ended up going to the hospital. His blood pressure was off the roof, you know, and then that's when we actually found out about everything. And from July to January, it was like on and off, on and off. It was like he had his moments, you know. He had his moments. If you see pictures of our reveal and then you see pictures on our baby shower, from June of our reveal, September our baby shower, to like January 1st for New Year's Eve, like, you could see the difference of how he was looking. But it was, yeah, it was bad. It was super hard. Let me see. I have another question. Does baking help you cope with things you've gone through in the last few months? Yeah, it does. You know, I've always loved baking, and baking to me is like, it's my thing. So it's like, you know, I try to forget everything and I just put my heart out on it. And, you know, not for nothing, because I'm not, you know, tooting my own hoop. But, you know, a lot of people always, when I bake stuff, they tell me, you know, it's good. Like, it's tastes amazing. And it's because, you know, I put my heart out to it, because that's been my passion for many years. Like, since I was like 5-6 years old, when I got my first easy bake oven. For real, all jokes aside, when I got my first easy bake oven. So baking is like, it helps me a lot. It's like, you know, my own little therapy, you could say. How have you been coping with the passing of your significant other? Does it motivate you more? You know, right now, I could say right now, I've been, you know, a lot better. You could see it. A lot of people tell me they could see it. I'm a lot better. I've gone to therapy. I put myself in therapy. I tried, when he passed away, I tried my hardest not to go in to depression, because that's just like, that's a dark place to go to. And you know, I have my daughter, and Melani motivates me like no other. If I didn't have her, honestly, I could say right now, I really don't know how or where I will be right now, because she motivates me every single day to keep on doing better for the both of us. You know, and it's, I sometimes overthink a lot, and that's a bad part about me, because I overthink a lot and then my anxiety goes up, and it's just, it's a hot mess. But you know, when I think a lot, it's just like, you know, it's hard. It is extremely hard to, you know, not only am I only just 21, but to be a single mother is even harder, because all I want to do is just be with her all day and just stay home. But you know, I have to provide for the both of us. I have to show her that, you know, mommy could do it. Daddy's no longer here, but mommy could do it. She could do it for all of us, for the three of us. And me and Dazz, we had a lot of plans, and we were actually going to move back to Salem, because he could have gotten, you know, better care over there. But I had always stopped from us moving so much for many reasons. But you know, once his passing, it's like, I don't want to go over there. I was going over there, you know, so I could go back to school. You know, my grandmother was gonna help me watch the baby. He was gonna get better care. And it's just like, now it's like, I don't want to, because he wanted to go so bad. But I just kept stopping it, and I just didn't want to go. But you know, I have my moments. But Dazz has, he also motivates me so much, and I am working so much just to, you know, have a better life for me and Melani. Something that he always wanted to do. And I'm gonna do it for us. I'm gonna do it for us, because that's a promise that, you know, we both have for each other, and I'm gonna do it. He thing is with him, I felt like he knew in his heart that, you know, he wasn't gonna be here for a long time. There was once he told me, he was like, you know, randomly too, he was like, you know, if it was to happen, I wouldn't be scared. And I'm like, what? I was so confused. I'm like, what? What are you talking about? He's like, if I was to pass away, I wouldn't be scared. I'm not scared to pass away. And I'm like, why are you even talking like that? Like, let's not talk about this. Like, that's not something I want to be thinking about. And, you know, his passing was, like, that morning. I could always relive that morning over and over and over again. And I always stopped myself. And something in my heart told me, something in my heart really did tell me, because I had a missed call from this number, then I had a voicemail, and I seen the voicemail first, and I remember it was a doctor. It said a doctor, and it said regarding Dazzmen Johnson. So I'm like, what's going on? I'm like, because I was gonna see him the next morning. Me and his dad were gonna go the next morning. I couldn't go with him because of the baby, and my mom worked and DJ went to school. And when I called and the doctor told me, you know, unfortunately, Dazz passed away at 6:20 a.m. That right there, just like, I felt everything crashing down, and I did not want to believe it whatsoever. I didn't want to believe it. I said, no, that's not true. No, that's not true. He just went yesterday. Like, how is that even possible? I just spoke to him. Like, how is that? And I knew there was something wrong, because usually he would text me and he didn't. So I'm like, what? And luckily, you know, my brother was still here at home. He grabbed the baby, and I just remember getting up from my bed, and I just screamed. And I said, no, this is not even possible. Like, no, like, it's not possible. I remember calling my mom. She was already halfway on her way to work. She had to come back. I remember just calling my dad and just everyone, because it just didn't feel right. It wasn't true. And I just remember telling the doctor, I want to see him. Please let me see him. He said, yes, he's here in the hospital. And I just remember getting dressed, and I just went to the hospital. I just couldn't even think right. They were, you know, checking me, my ID, and I'm just like, you know, where do I go? Where? And they said the ICU, and I just remember just seeing that one room with the curtains closed, and I'm just like, no, this is not true. Like, this just can't. When I just saw him there, and it's just, that he was no longer here. And I just remember going to him and just hugging him. And I just couldn't let go. The doctors came in. Nurses came in. And it just, I just wanted to be by myself. I didn't want to let go at all. And, you know, when I tell people, they always tell me, don't think like that. And just, two of my biggest regrets is that night when he left in the ambulance. We always do. We always say this to each other. We always say, I love you. And that day, well, that night, I didn't. All I said was, I'll see you tomorrow morning. Me and your dad are gonna go tomorrow morning. And I didn't say I loved you. And I know he knows that, but I feel like something inside would have made me feel a little bit better saying it to him. him knowing that I did. And just, you know, not being there with him, because I would always be in the hospital. I was 8 months pregnant, swollen feet. I was before, the night I got induced, he was in the hospital. The night I got induced, I was in the hospital the whole day. Swollen feet and all, like, ready to freaking burst. And I was there until 10, 12 at night. I was there. I never left his side when he was in the hospital. Never left his side. You know, he was my best friend. Like, I had to be there for him. And, you know, he's in New York. His father, his family, they're all in New Jersey. You know, his dad couldn't come all the time, so I didn't want him to feel like he was all by himself. But that night, I felt like, you know, he was by himself. Like, why didn't I go? Why didn't I stay there with him? Would things be different? Like, if the paramedics came and they told him, oh, you're full of liquid, because he didn't go to dialysis, you're full of liquid. Hospitals have dialysis machines. Was he on one? Did he, like, what was it? Like, I just have so many questions, and I feel like they were never answered. And little by little, I'm becoming at peace with his death, but I'm still not at peace with it, because it shouldn't be. And the other regret is, you know, he had to go that Wednesday, the day of my mom's birthday, and he didn't. And what if, you know, I wish I would have pushed him harder to say, you know, go, you have to go, you know. But he wanted to be there for my mom, and I just wish, you know, I could have pushed him harder, because, you know, maybe he would be here with me today. I just wish I could just, if I had one wish, honestly, it would to start that week over again and just do things so much different. It was, you know, and he never, a lot of people also say, you know, ask me, oh, was he ever on a waiting list for new kidneys? And yes, he was on the waiting list, but his doctors, you know, thought it would be better if his siblings, like, if his siblings were a match or someone close to him was a match, it would be better. But Dazz being Dazz, super hard-headed, he never wanted to put his family through it. I even offered, and he was like, no, you need your kidneys. I'm like, but if I'm a match, I would give it to you. I don't, you know, this, we're a partnership. Like, this is a partnership. If you needed it, like, I will give it to you. If I ever needed it, you will give it to me. Like, things like that. Like, it could have, you know. And we never tested myself, because, you know, that's another thing I also regret. Like, what if? And a lot of people tell me, don't say what ifs. But what if I was a match, you know? I could have gave it to him. He maybe could have been here. Like, if there's a lot of things I could prevent, I just could prevent that whole week and just start all over again. And just maybe Milani will have her dad here and see her grow up. And there's times, you know, I enjoy every moment I spend with my daughter. I look at life so much different now. Because, you know, my aunt had passed away in September, last September. Then my great-grandfather in October. Now I knew, you know, my great-grandfather would pass away, because he was already 90 years old, you know. But Dazz's death was super shocking, because he was 23. He was healthy, and it's just like that one thing killed him. And I just wish, you know, I could have helped him so much more. I wish I did. But yep, this is his you call these obituaries from his funeral. It's a beautiful picture that one of his friends' brother had done. It's beautiful. I'll read it to you guys because, you know. Let's see. Dazzmen Lamont Johnson, aka Candyman. The reason why they called him Candyman is because he, when he was in high school, he would go to BJ's and get a box of candy and he would sell the candy. Listen, you had to make your money somehow, some way. So he used to sell candy. He used to sell candy to the teachers and everything. I know in Marble Hill, where I used to go to, there was Abdul. This boy named Abdul, he used to sell candy. Mr. Paris used to always be on him, but he used to come in clutch though. But in his high school, Dazz was the candy man. Was born on January 4th, 1995 in Elizabeth, New Jersey. Son of Clifford and Diana. Dazzmen lived in Linden most of his life and graduated from Linden in 2014. Dazzmen continued his education at Monroe College in New Rochelle, New York, where he majored in criminal justice. He was an outstanding rugby player. He became the captain and quickly established himself as an electric leader. He was named team captain and later its first most valuable player, MVP. Dazzmen was a determined young man with a bright future ahead of him. He was a sportsman and a standout athlete who played basketball, ran track field, and started a 3-year varsity quarterback for Linden High School. Sorry, I forgot to tell you guys, he played track and field too. Well, he did track and field. His career stats were, now I don't know nothing about this, so majority of you guys do know football. I have no idea about football, so this was amazing, I guess. I don't know. I just see numbers. 2,685 passing yards, 22 passing touchdowns, 596 rushing yards, and 5 rushing touchdowns during his youth. He played football for Pop Warner. His favorite team was the Philadelphia Eagles, and it's crazy because that February that happened, the Eagles won. Now, people be like, oh, the Eagles won. They won for Dazz. Dazzmen was a caring, loving, outstanding young man who loved life to the fullest. Dazzmen was a family-oriented and very close to his siblings. He was known as the big brother. He was the big brother of, there's 5 of them, and he was the oldest one. He met the love of his life, Chelsea Espinal, while in college, and they were blessed with one daughter, Melani Avery. On Friday, January 5th, 2018, Dazzmen Lamont Johnson passed away from a brief illness at New York Presbyterian Hospital in New York at the age of 23. You know, that was Dazz. He loved his siblings. You know, no one could tell him anything. He was very, very proud of his siblings, very proud. Especially his two youngest brothers, Daniel and Tyrese. He was very, very, very proud of them. When we first met, he was like, yeah, I have a brother that was in the army, and I have another brother that works with millionaires. So I used to joke around with him. And I'm like, and what happened to you? What happened to you? And he used to be like, I'm an athlete. I does this. I'm like, okay, cool. But he was very proud of them. He was he loved his two little sisters. Loved his two little sisters. Like any brother. He was super overprotective with them. And he was always, every time he used to go over there, he used to always be on his sister, Tashia, the youngest one. Like, every time she would try to go outside, he's like, no, where you going? Like, I used to be like, Dad, you're not the father. Like, let her be. She's about to be 18 years old. Let her be. She could do what she wants. Let her be. And he was always on her about school. And she graduated this June. Me and Melanie, we went to her graduation. I'm very proud of her. She did it. You know? She did it. I just want to show, weird, irrelevant, but I want to show you. I still have this rose of where, like, he gave me this for my birthday. It was so funny because my birthday's on the 3rd, and we went to Jersey on the 2nd, and we were on our way back. And we were going to go to the supermarket, and this man, like, randomly passed by with roses, and he was like, hey, sir, let me get that rose. And I'm waiting for the light to change, and he comes, he goes, here, happy early birthday. And it was a rose, and I'm like, oh, thank you so much. It was like, you know, it's the little things that count. And he was just so sweet, and he was very private. Like, at first, you know, because we were in college, he didn't, you know, want, because we dormed, so everyone knew everything, basically. So, you know, we had to always be low-key, because we didn't really, when once people enter your relationship, you know, it always messes up from there. And he, you know, at first, like I said, at first, it was very rocky. So we were so good, and, you know, we wanted to keep it private until, you know, we were ready to, you know, say we're official. This is us, Chelsea and Dazz, Dazz and Chelsea. But I'm always gonna have love for him, always, you know. We share something, you know, we shared something, beautiful moments, but we share a precious little girl, Melani, and, you know, I thank him so much because, you know, he left a part of him here. And when I say he left a part of him, I really mean it. Because that little girl, she is just like her daddy. Like, always. He was always the type that he thought he was Rico Suave. He felt like he could get away with everything. And that's exactly how she is. She thinks she could get away with everything. No, because you're cute? No, you're not going to get away with everything. Not with me. No. Mm-mm. We're not doing that. But, you know, I'm so happy, you know, that I spent my pregnancy with him. As you can see, look at this beautiful picture. Like, my cousin, Papo. Well, I call him Papo. Well, the family calls him Papo. But Mikey, he took amazing maternity pictures. My reveal was just amazing. Baby shower was just amazing, you know. And I'm so happy that he got to spend, if it was meant for him to leave this earth, I'm happy that he was able to spend Melani's first holidays with her. Thanksgiving, Halloween. Well, Halloween we didn't do much because that was the day my great-grandfather passed away. But Thanksgiving, Christmas, you know, New Year's, I got to spend, you know, my first birthday, my 21st, with him and Melani. We got to spend his birthday with him and Melani. That's really all he wanted, was to spend it with us. And he did spend it with us. And, you know, January 5th will forever be a day that will hurt me so much. But I have to, you know, move forward. I have to keep on going because I know he doesn't want me to just be stuck. I know he wants me to keep on going. And just know I'm gonna make it. I'm gonna make it. I'm gonna make it for us. Me, Melani, and Dazz. I'm gonna make it because that was our goal and our dream. And it's gonna happen. It's gonna happen. Mark my words, it's gonna happen. I hope I, you know, give you guys some more understanding of who he was. If I didn't, you know, let me know. I will try to make a part 3. But yeah. I hope you guys liked it. Like this video, give it a thumbs up. Make sure to subscribe to this channel. There's a lot more stuff coming. And yeah, I hope to see you guys soon. Bye-bye.